Welcome. So today let's talk about measurement instruments. What are they and why do we need them? This is kind of an important thing when we move forward in looking at not only why do we need to take measurements, but how do we take measurements? So when we talk about measurement instruments, it's a bit broader than the physical types of measurements that we've been talking about earlier in the class. So in this broad context, we're saying any device, technology, could be a methodology or a process, that reduces our uncertainty of something that we're interested in or a measure in. And understand that unaided human observation has its limits. So measurement instruments helps us extend, if you think about it, our senses and our ability to know things outside of just what we can do with our five senses or six senses, whatever, however many senses you think we have. So here's some different examples. Things like an MRI machine allows us to see into the body and see soft tissues that we can't do with our physical eyes. Thermometers let us give a sense of absolute temperature, which ironically, our bodies aren't really good at absolute temperature. We're really good at changes in temperature. We feel heat transfer. Like if you have a cool breeze that comes across you, you feel that exchange and it feels colder to you. Versus if you have a warm breeze cross you, it feels warmer than it is because now you're getting heated up from that warm breeze. And other types of things, Geiger counters that give you different types of radioactive measurements that you can't detect yourself. Customer surveys, this is actually a non-technical methodology, it doesn't have to be, where you're getting information by doing an action, by doing a process that you don't have just by yourself by observation. Quality control sampling is another one of those. Flow meters to get accurate flow rates, and a whole series and series of others. So try to think for yourself, what are some of those things that you're not realizing that you're using a measurement instrument to get information or knowledge about your surroundings or a process or a company or wherever you're at. Now there's major advantages relative to just unaided human observation. One, instruments can allow us to extend our senses way beyond what we can. All you have to do is think of a telescope and it allows you to see things out in space that you can't see. Or a microscope allows you to see things very, very, very small that you can't see with the naked eye. Those are the types of things we're talking about. You can do the same thing with sound. You can do the same thing in a bunch of different domains. The other thing that's oftentimes what we want out of an instrument is we want it to be consistent. That the measuring process is reliable and repeatable. Sometimes that's a more difficult task than others. Calibration, in other words, can we calibrate it to a known measurement so that we know when it's telling us information that it's actually giving us something that's accurate and not just any old number, right? So, for example, you have like a pressure gauge that isn't measuring right on your tires. You want to make sure that your pressure gauge is giving you accurate pressure on your tire so that your tire is not going flat, you don't know it, right? So you need to be able to make sure that they're calibrated and working properly. And sometimes this is something that you have to repeat. Also, sometimes you have to have controls where you have known error sources and you want to be able to rule out those error sources. In optics, we see this a lot with surrounding light or ambient light that we don't want versus maybe a light that we're using to actually make a measurement. Whether it's a laser light or an LED light that might be giving us information off of something, but we have to subtract out the ambient light. That's kind of an example of control. There's several other types as well. Also, we want to minimize bias. We want procedures and processes in place so that our own bias or what our desires for the outcome to be aren't just happening because we desire them, right? So this is something where we're trying to minimize mostly human bias. And this is where we do blind protocols in studies, meaning that the people doing the study let's say they're doing a clinical trial and they're doing a study on different people. They don't know if a person is positive for a disease or negative for a disease. They just have them numbered. And so they do the analysis blind. And then there's also double blind where even the evaluators, once they're evaluating that data, it's all coded. So they don't know which way the actual patients may be, whether they're getting treated for the disease or if they're getting treated with a placebo. they don't know. They're just analyzing the data, and then in the end, it comes out which was what. So that's a way they can minimize bias. Also, record keeping. So we need to keep records of the data that we gather. Also, if we can do things that are faster, much more efficient, this is where we get into manufacturing automation, those types of things, where you want to have faster measurements or maybe cheaper than if you were trying to do something manually. So the other issue that comes up sometimes is there are some things that we can't measure directly. And in those situations, we have to figure out and maybe intuit or research ways that we can find relationships between things that we can measure and the things that we're trying to measure. In that way, oftentimes we can infer the measurement from another measurement. And we have to do this in lots of different scenarios. So let's say, for example, we want to know the mass of the Earth. We want to estimate that. Well, we don't have a scale that big, right? We can't just measure and sit the Earth on a scale and say, oh, it weighs this much or it's got this much mass. We don't have that type of tool. So what you have to do is over the millennia, actually, we've figured out ways to do better and better estimates. You know, it may have started out where we look at an arc. And so somebody takes a line of sight and then they know the distance of how far they have the line of sight from the next person on the line of sight. And they notice that there's an angle difference. And they do that a couple times and they can calculate this arc. Once they have this arc, they can mathematically look at the arc and realize that this would go all the way around. And how big would that be for a circle, essentially? And of course, with the assumption of the sphere, they can do a volume. And then they can then take, you know, samples of soil and different parts and get averages on that and say, okay, for this amount of volume, it's this amount of mass. And then they realize, okay, well, let's estimate that for the entirety of that volume. And then you get an estimate for the mass of the Earth. Now, it's gotten way more refined than that, but you get the idea. Other things like business cases for a new technology, that's a toughie. You don't know exactly what it is. You can benchmark what else is out there, gives you an idea of some scope, and that's why you see tons of different types of market studies that try to size markets and get ideas of who the players are and trying to estimate what that market size is. The other type of thing you can do is do types of surveys and try to figure out what does the demand feel like or what does it seem like the interest is in certain areas. And so on and so on. There's lots of different ways to get some data to try to get an estimate on what we're looking for. The whole point of this, the whole purpose of this is to try to take what wide uncertainty is, where you say, I don't know anything about this, versus, well, we know a little bit of this and we know a little bit of that. And if you add up more and more things that give you a better and better idea of what's going on, your uncertainty shrinks. When your uncertainty shrinks enough that you feel like, okay, now we can make some educated decisions on this, that's when you have enough of an estimate that you're like, okay, we can move forward. Now, again, there's direct types of observations and indirect types of observations. Different direct types that we see in manufacturing, in technology management, over and over again is, say, for example, we need to do counting or tracking of goods, you know, products, number of transactions, number of sales calls, all types of things like this are things that you can count, you can track. That's very direct. There's also things for statistical quality control. We can do randomized sampling. So we can look at number of failures in a batch. Are we targeting the right amount of ounces in a beer bottle, right? When we're manufacturing those, or what's the average time on a video, number of defects on a product. So that's related to counting, but it gets into more sampling of targets or portions. We can also do experiments like we talked about before, like double-blind studies, laboratory studies. So this is where we can do different types of studies let's say we do studies at a cellular level, and then we do a study at an animal level, model level, or maybe we finally get confident enough that we can do a study at the human level for maybe a medicine where we're trying to cure some disease. So in that way, we can infer and try to weed out something that looks promising versus things that are not, and don't bother to go all the way up at the high risk later on. market testing, another way. You can do pilot testing on markets. You can do A-B testing on markets. Let's try out marketing strategy A. Let's try out marketing strategy B. Same with even product testing, you can do that. And so then the other one is also active investigating. The EP method, this is where you're using an empathic path. This is where you're actually walking the walk. So people that are facing problems all the time or facing issues, you're going to learn so much more if you actually go with them and spend a day with them or spend a week with them within their problems and what they're dealing with. You're going to more intuitively understand what's going on by that investigation than if you're just looking from the outside in, or even just with surveys. It'll give you a different thing. Customer discovery interviews. This is where you're doing one-on-ones, where you have face-to-face interviews with people and getting their feedback on things with a lot of open-ended questions. And then things like Ono Circle, which is an observation technique that they use in a lot of manufacturing lines, where you just observe behavior and you jot down notes while you're at it. So those are direct types. There's also indirect observation types, things like surveys and analytics, other types of associated research, and that's where you're looking at research that ties in maybe to that same marketplace or similar phenomenon. Analytics, this is where we're tracking different behavior. This has become a big, particularly with website and social media analytics and tracking, because maybe we want to look at how well are we converting from when we have an initial touch point with a customer to them actually either buying a service or buying a product or engagement, if that's the business that you're in. Then what we're going to be doing later on in Sprint 3 is we're going to be actually looking at surveys themselves. And this is where we're trying to get a sense of customer interest in the product or service. What kind of price sensitivity, what's kind of a good range to start from with a price? Because we may not know, particularly in a new space. We may have benchmarks from other products or services that might be similar. That may be a piece of information, but we also want to directly get some price sensitivity in the target market from the target customers that we're looking at, and what's in general the market sentiment. So these are a little bit more indirect observation types that we can use to get information to help with business cases. Okay, another piece that we want you to understand is when you don't know everything and you don't necessarily have enough data to make classical statistical analysis, and you only know a bit, what kind of stats can you use as you are learning? Because eventually you'll probably get there. And this is where the difference between what we call a T-stat and a Z-stat comes in. Some of you may remember this. Some of you, this is new. So when you have only a little bit of information, how much confidence do you have with a little bit of information? And ironically, this was developed by William Silly Gossett. This is a chemist and statistician at Guinness, a brewery in Dublin, Ireland. And so essentially what they found was there's a little bit different way to do a stat that estimates our standard deviations. So remember, our standard deviations on a mean is we have a target, which is our mean that we have a desired. And then we have, from our data set, we have plus or minus a certain amount as a standard deviation that we can calculate. Now, if you don't have lots of data, you don't know what that full standard deviation population is. If you have greater than 30, say, data points, then you can generally use the Z-stat, which is what you see in most standard statistical textbooks. And so the Z-stat then represents exactly standard deviation on a normal table. It's a normalized normal curve, and the Z-stat, the Z actually is the same thing as the standard deviation. If it's one standard deviation, Z is one. If it's two standard deviations, Z is two, and so on. And same with the negative direction. So negative standard deviation is minus one, or minus two for two standard deviations in the negative direction. And when we're trying to determine control limits, well, that matters because we use a target, but we then add a standard deviation, or if we want roughly 99% confidence, it's usually three standard deviations to the right. And so we add three standard deviations times the value from where we are, or we subtract three standard deviations times the value from the mean so that we can get those control limits. But if we don't have that much data, let's say we're just starting to figure out our data. Let's say we've got five data samples. Can we use the z-stat? Well, it turns out that there's an adjustment you can make that adjusts down, and it's called the t-stat. And it's really useful in these cases when you have less than 30 samples. Now, it's a little bit different to calculate. So when we calculate that, I don't know why this thing keeps... there's actually several steps. So first step, take a random sample measurements. And again, this is when you don't actually have enough to be beyond 30 samples. If you can make 30 samples, great. Use that. Use the z-stat. Don't have to worry about it. But if you can't, for a variety of reasons, you may not be able to, then you can use this method. Then you calculate what we call a sample variance. Now in Excel, this command is called the var.s command. And I'll show you in a second what that looks like. The next piece that you do is you calculate the standard deviation of estimate of the mean. So again, this is that plus or minus value that we're looking for. Then we'll look up or use, now you can look up on a table if you like, or in Excel, they also have a function that has the values. It's the t.inv.2t. That's the newer command that they use in Excel to give you the t-stat. And then you can calculate the upper and lower confidence intervals. So let me show you what that looks like in a spreadsheet that I have. So I will bring that up. So actually, I will show you what it looks like when it's fully fleshed out. That's just easier. That bigger. And I will zoom this in so you can see it. Okay, so we have some raw data here, and it's whatever this data is. Now, I just have five sample points. Remember, this would be anything from two. You have to have at least 2 points. You can't not have 2 points. Really, it's probably between 5 and 29 points. So this is our raw data that we measured. To be able to calculate things, first of all, we have to calculate the average. So that's our mean right there, 1.4. Now, our standard deviation estimate of the mean is different than what we call the sample standard deviation. So notice the sample standard deviation is stdev.s. This gives us a value of 0.187. The problem with that is that is based upon the z-stat on a normal curve. So we need to actually do a different calculation called this standard deviation of estimate of the mean. Now, how do we do that? First off, we have to take the square error of these data points. Now, the square error is you have to take the average, if you notice. So it's taking the average minus each of the raw data points. So each data point you subtract from the average, then you square it. And you get a squared error for each and every one of these values. Now, some of these show zero probably because it's just very small. It's exactly the same, 1.4 and 1.4. Some of them have a very small squared error. Then we calculate the variance. Now, the variance is basically the sum of the squared errors, right? So it's the sum of all of these divided by the count of all of these. So we have 5. You could type in 5, but I just used count, the count command, minus 1. So we actually lose 1 degree of freedom. And so you get this value, 0.035. The other way you could do it, this will give you the same thing, if you calculate the variance.s, and that's the command I was showing you on the previous slide, also gets you to the same place. So that's calculated exactly the same way, 0.035. The standard deviation of the mean, then, is the square root of the variance divided by the count. And that is where it differs. It's just by the count. There's no change at that point for degrees of freedom or anything like that. And that's essentially it for the standard deviation of mean. Once you have that, you can look up the t-stat. The t-stat is going to give you, and this is where that command t.inv.2t comes in. 2t stands for two-tail, and it's the inverse function. Now, this 0.01 here is the probability that we're interested in the t-stat. So the probability in this case is 10%, which is what we think of as what's in those two tails, which means 90% we want in between. So if we want 90% confidence, then in this function, you take 100 minus 90, you get 10% left. That's the probability left over in those tails, kind of like alpha. It's similar. And then we get the degrees of freedom, which is the count of the number of points we have. So again, because we have 5 points, it's 5 minus 1, or 4. And that's, and that function gets us the t-stat. And again, it's 90% confidence interval. And that's why we put the 0.1 in there. So it's a little, it's not quite intuitive on how that function works. So make sure that you put that in correctly. So this is what we're going to use instead of the z-stat. So instead of the sampled standard deviation times z, we actually use the standard deviation estimate of the mean times t, and we're going to add and subtract that from the average. And that's exactly what this is. For the upper bound, it's those two things multiplied and added to the average. And if we want to look at the lower bound, it's those two things times and subtracting that from the average. And that's pretty much it. So it kind of gives you your confidence on your data, whether it's falling in or out. Now, again, the more data you get, the more confident this changes, the t-stat will go up. And eventually you get to a point where you could use the z-stat and use standard classical statistics. But it's kind of a good way for you to know and give you some kind of idea if your confidence level at 90% is there or not in what you're measuring before you've really spent a lot more time and money and invested into a process to get to those higher levels. And so it's a way to see if you're going in the right direction or not, or what kind of confidence you have in your data. All right. So that's it for that. Thank you so much. And I will see you in class. All right. Take care.